In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
As we gather, we acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which this cathedral is built, the Wangaratta people, and we pay our respects to the elders, past and present. And we pay our respects to all First Nations people present here today.
Jesus said to his apostles, "You are my friends if you obey my commands."
About that time, King Herod laid violent hands upon some who belonged to the church. He had James, the brother of John, killed with the sword. After he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. This was during the festival of unleavened bread. When he had seized him, he put him in prison and handed him over to 4 squads of soldiers to guard him, intending to bring him out to the people after the Passover. While Peter was kept in prison, the church prayed fervently to God for him. The very night before Herod was going to bring him out, Peter, bound with 2 chains, was sleeping between 2 soldiers, while guards in front of the door were keeping watch over the prison. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He tapped Peter on the side and woke him, saying, "Get up quickly," and the chains fell off his wrists. The angel said to him, "Fasten your belt and put on your sandals." He did so. Then he said to him, "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me." Peter went out and followed him. He did not realize what was happening with the angel's help was real. He thought he was seeing a vision. After they had passed the first and the second guard, they came before the iron gate leading into the city. It opened for them of its own accord, and they went outside and walked along the lane, and suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I am sure that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from the hands of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting." Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. reading from St. Paul's second letter to Timothy. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack, and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When they finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my lambs. A second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter felt hurt because he had said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, Follow me. Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following them. He was the one who had been lying next to Jesus at the supper and had said, Lord, who is it that is going to betray you? When Peter saw him, he said to Jesus, Lord, what about him? Jesus said to him, If it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? Follow me. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Matching and dispatching. meaning that we will be doing baptisms, marriage ceremonies, and funerals. However, it is not simple as it may sound. As priests, we are involved in the lives of those whom we serve, from the cradle to the grave. This comes with an enormous responsibility. We do not apply for the ordination to holy orders. It is a calling that comes at a tremendous cost to the person who answers that call. Those who come to be ordained must realize that our calling demands a total commitment and obedience to Christ. We have made the choice to relinquish our lives for the sake of the gospel. We have surrendered control to Christ, and therefore we are led by God's Spirit and never our own. This is the realization of St. Paul when he says, I live no more, for Christ lives in me. We therefore live and act in the person of Christ, persona Christi. This demands that we live in prayer and with the constant discernment of seeking God's will, never our own. Not an easy task. I'm journeying with daily reflections by Richard Rohr, and his theme for this year is, we do not stand alone. Yes, we do not stand alone. We have mentors. We have spiritual directors. We have supervisors. We have spiritual companions and guides on our life's journey. We only need to ask and seek them out. Our challenge is to live every day in deep reflection and prayer. Your ordination, David, was initially planned to be on the feast of St. Peter and St. Paul. So we kept the readings of that feast for today. David, can always draw from their lives and their example on your journey as a priest in the Church of God. Now let's take a look at these two. Most of the apostles and lots of the saints have their own feast day. But how about the two most famous saints of the early church? There is the 18th of January, in which the church celebrates the confession of Peter, the sign that Peter was the first among the apostles and the one designated to lead the early church after Jesus' resurrection and ascension. The painting of Paul Rubens showed Peter with the keys and wearing the mantle of the office of a bishop. But there is no feast of St. Peter. St. Paul, although one of the 12 was an apostle commissioned by Jesus, there is January 25th, the celebration of the conversion of St. Paul, which commemorates the Damascus Road episode describing Acts of the Apostles, and made famous in a painting by Caravaggio. But there is no feast of St. Paul. The two leading saints of the early church are celebrated together in the feast of St. Peter and St. Paul, as they seem to be together shaping the church, the yin and the yang. This celebration is a liturgical feast in honor of the martyrdom in Rome of the apostles St. Peter and St. Paul, and is observed on the 29th, which we have translated to today's celebration of this ordination. They are not honored for leading and growing the church, but for their martyrdom. How did Peter live in the person of Christ, in persona Christi? It is quite clear from Scripture that Peter had a struggle from the very start. He realized who Jesus was, but often got in the way. He was even under Jesus' supervision, personal supervision, daily for 3 years. And yet, at his final test, he turned to denial. He denied all he wants, all he was taught, and the very one who taught him everything. He needed constant help. It is with the help of the Holy Spirit that Peter comes to his own, and yet, being the leader of the way of Christ, the body of Christ, the church, Peter had to be called out by Paul for his hypocrisy when he refused to eat with the Gentiles in the presence of the Jews, although he ate with the Gentiles before. And so how did Paul live persona Christi? St. Paul was no fisherman. He was of noble upbringing and a brilliant scholar. He was a Pharisee and knew the Jewish faith like the palm of his hand. In his zealousness for the Jewish faith, he persecuted the people that believed in the way of Christ. He was responsible for the death of many until his confrontation by Christ and his subsequent conversion to the way of Christ. And thereafter, it became a constant struggle for Paul to prove himself as an apostle, as a follower, as a witness of Christ. His corpus of letters to the various churches reflects his commitment and dedication. Still, Paul was aware of his shortcomings and need for guidance. He was quite open about them. The significance for both of them is that they both had a name change. Simon became Peter, Cephas, and Saul became Paul. In our gospel reading, Jesus asked Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these other disciples?" And then asked another 3 times. Peter's response was, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Feed my lambs, tend my sheep, feed my sheep." At the 3rd time, Peter felt heard and said with all his heart, "Lord, you know everything." After this, Jesus said to him, "Follow me." The ministry that we are called to is Christ's ministry. We do it in the way of Christ, and therefore, Christ ministers through us. St. Paul declares in his second letter to Timothy, "I have kept the faith." He admits his dependence on God to have been able to do this. "The Lord stood by me," he said, "and gave me the strength so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might aid." Nothing is done by us. We are not capable. God does everything through us. So how do you and I live in the person of Christ? Our living with this is to love as Christ has loved, to love without reserve, to keep the flock together, no matter how difficult it may be, and to hold everyone and every situation in prayer, every day, as long as we live. We need to become sacrament and live sacramental lives. A sacrament is defined in the Latin West as the visible sign of the inner spiritual grace. In the Eastern Greek understanding, a sacrament is in the likeness of Christ, in his death and resurrection. It is passage from the old to the new. In baptism, water becomes a level of regeneration. In the Eucharist, the earthly food, bread and wine is transformed in the body and blood of Christ, while with oil we are granted the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, everything in the world can be identified, manifested and understood as a gift of God and participation in the new life. A sacrament is both cosmic and eschatological. In nature, as it refers to God's world, as God has created it to its fulfillment in the kingdom of God. It is cosmic, for it embraces all of creation and returns to God as God's own, and in and by its help, it manifests the victory of Christ. It is eschatological, for it is concerned with the kingdom which is to come. Therefore, the Church is a sacrament in the cosmic sense, because she manifests in this world the genuine world of God as God first created it. The Church is a sacrament in the eschatological dimension, because the original world of God is of God's creation, which is revealed by the Church, has already been revealed by Christ. Therefore, the Church creates, manifests, and fulfills herself in and through the sacraments. Sacraments belong to Christ. It is not ours. So how do we live sacramentally? What does this mean? When we live in the likeness, we receive God's grace through the death and the resurrection of Christ, and therefore have this amazing invitation to be a sacramental presence. A sacramental life is the essence of being within God's grace. We become the signpost and the presence of God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven, as we continue. Let thy kingdom come in us and through us. Sacramental living is to live what we believe. It is to be what we believe. This is your and my challenge there. But it's also our joy and privilege, as we know we do not stand alone. We have the Holy Spirit to guide us in all truth and in the way of Christ, into the likeness of our Lord, who through us will share his sacraments, his grace, his love, and his life. I want to leave you with some of the words of the prayer of the breastplate of St. Patrick. Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me. Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ on my right, Christ on my left, Christ when I lie down, Christ when I sit down, Christ when I arise, Christ in the heart of everyone who thinks of me, Christ in the mouth of everyone who speaks of me, Christ in every eye that sees me, Christ in every ear that hears me. I arise today through a mighty strength, the invocation of the Trinity, through belief in the threeness, through confession of the oneness of the Creator of creation. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Dear friends of Christ, you know the importance of this office. We have been assured that David is suited for this ministry. If, however, any of you know an adequate reason why we should not proceed, come forward and make it known. So let us now pray for David, now to be ready.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send your peace to the world, which you have reconciled to yourself by the ministry of your Son, Jesus.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heal the divisions of your church, that all may be one, so that the world may be
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lead the members of your church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve you in true and godly living.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Raise up faithful and able ministers for your church, that the gospel may be known to all people.
And body purchased at the cost of his own life. Remember that you'll be called to give an account before Jesus Christ. If it should come about that the church or any of its members is hurt or hindered as a result of your negligence, you know the greatness of the fault and the judgment that will follow. Therefore, apply yourself with diligence and care, and fashion your life and ministry in accordance with Christ's example. As you depend on the Holy Spirit and the grace of God, put away all that does not make for holiness of life. Clothe yourself with humility. Be constant in prayer. Study the scriptures wholeheartedly, reflecting with God's people upon their meaning, so that your ministry and life may be shaped by Christ. We have every confidence that you have already pondered these things deeply. And now, in order that this congregation may understand your intention, and so that your public profession may strengthen your resolve, answer clearly these questions which you ask me in the name of God and Jesus. Do you believe that you are truly called to this order and ministry of priests, according to the will of our Lord Jesus Christ and the order of this Anglican Church of Australia?
I believe that I am called to this ministry.
Are you convinced that the Holy Scriptures contain all doctrine necessary for eternal salvation through faith in Jesus Christ? And are you determined to instruct from these Scriptures the people committed to your care, teaching nothing as essential to salvation which cannot be demonstrated from the Scriptures?
I am convinced and will do so by God's grace.
Will you be diligent in prayer and in the study of the Holy Scriptures?
I will, by God's grace.
Will you undertake such studies as will deepen you in your ministry?
I will, by God's grace.
Will you constantly stir up the gift of God which is in you, so that you may proclaim the gospel of Christ?
I will, by God's grace.
Will you faithfully and humbly minister the doctrine, sacraments and discipline of Christ, as he has commanded, as this church has received?
I will, by God's grace.
Will you be ready, both in your public and private ministry, to oppose and set aside teaching that is contrary to God's word?
I will, by God's grace.
Will you be a faithful pastor to all who are called to serve and lead, striving together with him to build up the body of Christ, truth and love, in unity and peace?
I will, by God's grace.
Will you encourage and enable those committed to your care to fulfill their ministry and mission in the world?
I will, by God's grace.
Will you obey your bishop and other ministers given authority over you, gladly and willingly following their godly and lawful directions?
I will, by God's grace.
God has given you the will to do these things. Give you the grace and power to perform them.
Amen. Amen.
People of God, you've heard this, our brother, respond to God's call to love and serve him as a priest. Will you accept him as a priest in the Church of God?
We accept him gladly.
Will you support and encourage him in this ministry?
We will, by God's grace.
Yeah.
Blessed are you, Lord, our God. You have given us the only Son to be the apostle and high priest of our faith, and the shepherd of our souls. Exalted as Lord of all, you poured out the Spirit and gave gifts to your people, making some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, and to build up the body of Christ. And now we give you thanks that you have called us your servant to the ministry of priests in your church. Send down the Holy Spirit upon your servant David, whom we set apart by the laying on of our hands for the work and office of a priest in your church. As the Father anointed his Son with the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, so may Jesus Christ preserve you to sanctify his people and to offer sacrifices of praise and thanksgiving. Take authority to preach the word of God and administer the holy sacraments in the congregation where you are appointed to serve. Whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven. Whose sins you retain, they are retained. Be a faithful minister of the word of God and of his holy sacraments. Grant to us, your servant, David, merciful God, grace and power to fulfill his ministry, to proclaim the gospel of salvation through word and sacrament, to declare the forgiveness of sins, and to watch over and care for the people committed to his charge. As you called him to your service, make him worthy of his calling. Accept our prayer through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, Lord, glory and honor, worship and praise, now and forever.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, I present you David, who has been ordained priest in the Church of God.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and you enhance it made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for your goodness we have this gift to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Blessed be God forever.
Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us and all your people to the joy of your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship your Father in songs of never-ending praise.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, and for uniting us to him in the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for raising up faithful servants for the ministry of your word and sacraments. May David be a godly example in word and action, love and penitence, and in holiness of life, that he may faithfully fulfill his ministry. May your word spoken through him never fail. Make us, with David, faithful witnesses of the Lord Jesus and his resurrection, and at his coming we may go out with great joy to meet him, and be found worthy to worship you with all your saints forever. Most loving God,
you send us into the world to your life. Give us grace to go thankfully and the courage to come from the heart of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
bring you with Peter and Paul and all the saints to the eternal and triumphant joy of that city, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.